Hello, everyone. Welcome back to Adventures Through the Mind, a podcast exploring topics relevant and related to psychedelic culture, medicine, and research, always with the underlying inquiry of how can we work with and through our psychedelic experiences to become better people, not just for ourselves, but for all those with whom we are nested in relationship, presently and across time, humans and non-humans alike. And in the exploration of these topics, we cover a range. In the exploration of this psychedelic-related content, we explore a range of things that are sort of more focused on the individual, personal healing, psychology, psychotherapy, emotions, sometimes more into the hard science mode, research and data and pharmacology and neuroscience and et cetera. Other times more focused on society and other times still more focused on the practicalities of journeying with psychedelics at various doses. And for this episode, we're going to be exploring a combination of society, personal healing, dosing protocols, practicalities, and science, which is that we're going to be talking with Baba Masha, who is the author of the new book, Microdosing with Amanita Muscaria, Creativity, Healing, and Recovery with the Sacred Mushroom, forwarded by James Fadiman, Dr. James Fadiman. Now, if you're not familiar with the Amanita Muscaria, you almost definitely are. It's the, for those listening, it is the mushroom with the red cap and the white dots that you see all over the place, especially this time of year. It is the holiday season of late in the Gregorian calendar. And many of you might be flooded with our annual flush of mushroom Santa Claus posts. Which this interview has nothing to do with. I have other interviews about that if you like, and your feed is probably littered with them. So if you came here for that, you're in the wrong place. This is a very different discussion, but about the same mushroom. And as always, I have a little overture to set the interview straight with you, or set the interview off right. I think off right makes more sense than straight. And you can read along at jamesw.jesso.com, where for the show notes to this episode, is what I'm reading here is what I'm going to post on the website. And here we go. Might Amanita muscaria mushroom microdosing be the next big trend on the psychedelic horizon? Perhaps. According to data collected by Baba Masha, pediatrician and OBGYN with a doctorate in medicine and a bachelor's degree in chemical engineering, as well as the author of the 2022 book, Microdosing Amanita Muscaria, the potential of microdosing the other magic mushroom includes, quote, help and healing for hormonal dysfunction, low libido, allergies, asthma, swelling, gingivitis, nail fungus, digestive issues, and skin conditions such as eczema and psoriasis, as well as recovery from stroke and cardiac arrest. This is literally written on the back of the book, as well as apparently relieving pain, depression, hypertension, insomnia, and even interrupting addiction. These are a pretty wide range of benefits and not even an exhaustive list. One, I believe correctly, might wonder how much of this is placebo and where the data to support these claims even came from. Thankfully, Baba Masha is on this episode of Adventures Through the Mind to outline this research, that data, and explore these questions with us, as well as a thorough look at exactly what microdosing Amanita muscaria looks like insofar as preparation and protocol. Additionally, it's important to couch this conversation with the fact that Baba Masha is a pseudonym, and her face and voice are disguised in this interview, and her true identity has been kept secret. Why? Because Masha hosted the Radio Psychedelics podcast in Russian since 2013, a podcast that has been twice banned by the Russian government. So in this episode of the podcast, we actually first start by exploring Masha's journey of making a banned podcast about psychedelics in Russia, being the first person to be public about consuming psychedelics in Russia, as well as the context of drug use and prohibitionist propaganda in Russia and its impact on public health. From here, Masha outlines the origins of her microdosing Amanita study, where the data came from, the results, the potential influence of placebo effect, some nuances about the chemical composition and pharmacology of Amanita, and what her study revealed about the optimal dosing and preparation protocols for microdosing the Amanita muscaria mushroom. So that is the overture. That's what we're getting into today. If it wasn't clear just a moment ago, I'll sort of like reiterate it now, which is that Masha is the name. Masha is disguised in this interview. She's literally wearing a disguise, but then I fractaled her face and then made her voice sound all, I don't know, hard copy for you 90s kids out there. So just a heads up, it is a disguised voice. She doesn't actually sound that way, and she isn't actually an entity from the DMT dimension visually. Anyways, so all that aside, one little piece before we get in that is also a huge piece is that this podcast is brought to you by my patrons on Patreon and other people who are supporting the show financially. Without the financial support of these people, I would not be able to continue producing the show. Without the sort of voluntary contribution of financial energy towards the investments financially and otherwise into what goes into the show and the larger body of my work that supports what goes into the show, it just wouldn't really exist the way that it exists. Sure, I could still be producing it, but I wouldn't be able to also pay my bills. And that would make it really difficult to put the time and energy into it that I do, and thus would alter what it ends up being for you. So, and what it ends up being for me. Am I rambling? I don't know. I'm really grateful. So thank you, because I love being able to do this as my job, as my full-time work. And people who support the show financially allow me to do that. The people whose names are listed on the show here who are listed on the screen here on YouTube or in the description of this episode give significantly, some of which for a long time. So an extra thank you to them. But generally, a huge thank you to all of the people that help make this show possible for me and for everyone else. So thank you. This is the last episode of 2022, and it's landing at the end of the year. And the next time I'll see you, it'll be the other side of the big Gregorian finale celebrations and the start of a new, cycle around the sun. I mean, arbitrary. It's our own quantification of, rates of change systematized into some sort of economically servicing organization. Anyways, but I wish you well. And so if you don't get all the way to the end of the interview where I can wish you well on the tail end, I'm wishing you well now. And I'm looking forward to seeing y'all all next year. And without further ado, here is my interview with Baba Masha on microdosing the Amanita muscaria mushroom. Episode 169 of Adventures Through the Mind. Enjoy. Okay. And you go by Baba Masha. Is that right?
You just can call me Masha because that's not my real name. You know what's going on in Russia right now. Yeah, we'll talk about it later. So Masha is fine.
Okay, great. Masha. And then I assume you're wearing a costume, like a disguise, right?
Yeah, because Baba Masha is a virtual character and it's animated. I'm a visual artist. I paint, I sculpt, I do videos, and I create a specific character just for my psychedelic podcast.
Oh, yeah.
Which I broadcasted for 8 years over Russia. And you know what's going on over there with, maybe you don't, but discussion of psychedelic plants, even medicinal properties, is highly prohibited and punished by government. So I was the very first person who went public and I said to Russian speaking territories, yeah, I smoke pot, I use the boba, I use ayahuasca, I eat mushrooms. And only in those purposes, I have to create specific character which not connected to my personal life, and it's not connected. I was broadcasting for 8 years. I had over 7 million views. They don't know who I am. And on my animation in my movies, I look like this.
Yeah. Cool. Well, that's great. That's a little piece. I want to know more about your story, but I'll tell you now if you want. I'm not sure how anonymous you want to be. I guess you probably don't scramble your voice, so that is what it is. But if you want to send me an animated, like a little drawing of a cartoon face, it shouldn't be too difficult for me to like set it up so that every time, so that it's a cartoon face that moves around and talks. But that's up to you. I can do some fun things, so I can talk to you about that when the time comes that I start producing it.
Yeah.
All right. Okay. So why don't you? All right, let's just say we're in the interview now. Baba right. Masha. Masha, welcome to Adventures Through the Mind.
Yeah, welcome for thank you for inviting me, Jesse. I'm glad to talk about my book. Here is my book. And I want to talk about how does it happen, because it was all synchronicity events and it was not planned.
Well, before we get into your book, and I want to get some expert perspective, expert information about the Amanita muscaria mushroom. I want to get a better sense of your story. Like, you alluded to it just a moment ago as you were talking about why you were, you know, you're wearing a disguise and sort of the history of your psychedelic podcast in Russia. But why don't you give us a little bit more of a thorough take of sort of the podcast that you're producing in Russia, sort of in the series of events that unfolded, I believe that inevitably led you to needing to leave Russia, if that's correct. It doesn't have to be too detailed, but yeah, give us sort of like a general overview of your story.
Okay. Are you gonna edit your podcast? So you can interrupt me anytime.
Oh, no, I don't generally edit. But okay. good to know that I could, I'll step in as necessary.
All right. So I studied, I left Russia 30 years ago, when my country collapsed and country where I was born doesn't exist anymore. And it was chaos. It was bad. So I left. And it's not connected to my psychedelic studies. I'm a doctor and I have a PhD. And when I moved here, I stumbled on psychedelic plants information. And being a doctor, I just got curious what it is, what's the alternative methods, even though we didn't discuss it in my medical school. So I studied psychedelic plants and other non-shamanic remedies over 10 years. All available science and my own experience as well. And to my surprise, I cured a severe health condition, which I was not be able to treat with pharma products for many, many years. So in 2014, I created a harm reduction program named Radio Psychedelics to broadcast it over Russian-speaking territories. And I was the first person who went public, and I started to talk openly about psychedelic plants, health benefits, history, medicinal use, rules, dosage, certain settings, including my own experience, which is cannabis, mushrooms, ayahuasca, cacti, iboga, bufo, and non-psychedelic remedies as a combo, rapé, sananga. I invaded a territory where discussion of medicine properties of psychedelic plants was criminal activity. Mm-hmm. And I'm sure you heard news about Brittany Greener.
Brittany Greener, no.
Oh, she's an American basketball player, and she was sentenced for 9 years for cannabis concentrate in Russia. Oh, but wow. It happened a few months ago, and today we freed her. So today is my holiday because we exchanged her for some criminal person which were arrested previously. So instead of going public as myself, I created cover-up, animated virtual figure Baba Masha from Crazy Town, And I actually scrambled my voice as well. So it's totally animated personage. I broadcasted radio psychedelics for 8 years, and I posted over 14,000 hours. It was just podcasts, live voice streams, anonymous interviews with psychedelic users. I translated books, articles, science. I presented people which are prohibited and banned in Russian-speaking territories. Timothy Leary, Aldous Huxley, Anton Robert Wilson, McKenna, Ram Dass, James Fadiman, Dick Strassman. So my podcast was banned twice by Russian government. First time in 2018. And second time in 2020, because I opened another one and in 2 years they found me and banned me too. What else? I ran several projects during my broadcast because it was interactive. It's not just I was talking, I was collecting public information because, you know, after 10 years going on our side, whatever it is, you know, I know you're a mushroom user, and I know you wrote books about mushrooms. I still didn't have a full picture of what it is. So this 8 years psychedelic podcast was created mostly for myself, because after talking with thousands and thousands of people personally, because I was anonymous, they were anonymous, we can't share anything, you know, when you talk with live person and you don't know, and that's give you different level of trust. So my project during my broadcast was collecting public information about addiction to marijuana products, microdosing with magic mushrooms, personal reports on health benefits, different psychedelic plants. And then all of a sudden, Amanita came in my life. And first person who told me about taking Amanita Muscaria in very tiny doses, I was against it. I reacted just a normal person. Normal doctor, don't do it. You're going to die. Your liver will fail. And then I started getting more and more information because in 2014, I read a James Fadiman book about microdosing with psychedelic mushrooms. And I tried it on myself. I did two courses, 6 months each. And I got great results, and I published them in 2016. So I end up with a group of 67 people taking Amanita in microdoses. They didn't know each other. They didn't know I'm talking with everybody almost twice a week to watch them in dynamic. And results and effects on their health were so consistent. And when I public that information on my podcast in 2019, in six months, I was loaded with information. Few thousand people actually wrote me about taking Amanita in small dosages. So I created a project. We didn't know what we're going to get. We didn't know how much we should take, what diseases can be affected. We didn't know anything, so it was rolling on its own. Let's say 5, 6, 7 people write me about, okay, I'm taking Amanita Muscaria in small doses, and my blood pressure goes down. So I immediately post the question for public discussion. By 2019 September, I had 2,000 people working with me live. And later, I created live chats. It was two live chats. we end up with 8,000 people alive, talking every day, all the time. How much did we take? What happened? What's the form of intake? What time of the day you have to take? I mean, it was rolling right in front of our eyes. It was all public, documented by me. I created a questionnaire, which include 150 different conditions, health conditions. And not all of them are 100% positive, you know, because I was not going for positive answers. I was going for answers. Does it help? It doesn't help, or it worse. So what else do you want to know?
You know, it was interesting timing because can you just pause a second? I just got somebody really loudly banging at my front door. So I should probably go check that out. It was actually perfect timing because you were just finishing up as they were knocking. So just one second. Well, that was interesting. It was FedEx, nothing that interesting, but normally they don't bang on my door and ring the doorbell over and over again. So that was weird. Anyways, it's a controlled delivery. They knew we were talking. No, I'm just kidding.
Yeah, good it was not Russian government.
Yeah, right. Okay, so with that said, so yeah, you got this incredible data set with respect to microdosing Amanita, and I want to ask you more about what you discovered there, but I want to go back a little bit and explore a bit about the context of having a psychedelic podcast in Russia. Like you had said that your podcast had been shut down a couple of times. What does shutdown look like? So like, to what degree, as in they like ban your URLs, they sort of like, they go in and track down your social identities. Like what did that look like?
All they did, they demanded from YouTube, put a geographical ban. So nobody, when people go on my podcast on YouTube, even I provide them the link. When we go on my account, it says, this account terminated, unsubscribe. If we start watching any of my movies, it says, it's prohibited in your country, unsubscribe. Just a black screen, that's it. So nobody in Russia can watch my videos, listen to my podcasts, but they can use a VPN and go around. So totally I have right now three different, still available in any other countries, you know. It's only Russian Federation cannot listen. Or watch my movies. It's not much about video. I give some videos, but it's not really needed. So after Russian Federation banned me, I created a Telegram channel. I have about 20 channels on Telegram social media. And it's all in one pile. I have a link for all my channels, and it's still Amanita Muscaria Microdosing, Psychedelic Mushroom Microdosing, Ayahuasca, separate channels with information for people to read. It's not voice, it's just information which I collected for all those 8 years. Let's say, how do you take psychedelic microdoses, and letters from people how microdoses affected their health, let's say depression. And I have a questionnaire about psychedelic mushrooms microdosing as well. So it's just all information I have, because I didn't do it for monetize my information. I even don't put advertising on my videos. I'm not interested in that. I was taking information from people and I gave it to them for free. In 2020, I wrote a book in Russian language, and I put all information I collected for those years and I gave it to them for free. You know, I put it in PDF format online. And by now I have a 250,000 downloads. And I don't want to charge them because it's not my information. I just systematize it and put it in different form, available for reading. Because, you know, in Russia, all this information is prohibited. It's absent. So young generation, they don't know what's good or bad. They think psychedelics is any chemical garbage we can buy for nothing on the street. You know, those bad designers drugs, which a lot of people get HPPD, they get sick, they got, you know, in 2018, Russian Federation banned me for, I will tell you exactly what I said, because I have an enormous amount of information from young people. They don't know how old I am, they don't know who I am, and they were willing to share. At least I was a person you can talk with about these things. They cannot talk with their parents. They cannot talk with their teachers. It's not like here, right? You can find people. You can talk about using cannabis. Is it good or bad? But in Russia, it's total darkness. So as soon as the information about Baba Masha spread over Russian territories, my audience, they're young people. They're like 18 to 30, 35. So I got the big picture what's going on in Russian Federation. And you know what? It's a government-mandated genocide of young people. Because you cannot get marijuana. You can get 7 years of prison for having, like, what, 10 grams, right? But you can buy designer drugs, which comes from China and India, in enormous amount for nothing. In a, the whole cities were loaded with crap. People were going crazy, committing suicide, and we were thinking, oh, we are using psychedelics. We heard somewhere Timothy Leary name and LSD, blah, blah, blah. But it's not about that. And as soon as I said, that's what's going on in your country, that's what it is. And next week, they shut me down.
Interesting. So what do you think it was that had you get shut down? Like, was it that you were pointing out the sort of like failures of the government regulations around psychedelics and its harm to the people? Or no, was it, what was it?
No, it was when I said it was genocide covered by government.
Yeah. So that's explicitly what you said. Yeah.
Right, because designer drugs, they are not created in Russia. They come in Russia in enormous amount, and we drop those chemicals, which is highly poisoned for mind and body. They dropped an enormous amount in the cities, and I had a lot of people who are working in patella anatomists. I got information with, they don't put real diagnosis of death. They say it's a stroke, it's some other cause of death, but not overdose with designer drug. You know, that was the first thought when I start asking people, how many people use it? How many people do you know using that drug? Because it was a waves, let's say a whole city is loaded with some unknown chemical drug, people dying, nobody cares, then it's something silent, and then another wave. The amount, it's just sad. That's the reason I started that podcast, and I still have a small chat with young people, just explain them and tell them what it is. What is this psychedelic revolution? Because, you know, it's normal when young people are dismissing all the knowledge what their parents tell them, right? But somebody have to tell them what's the difference between psychedelic plants, what's the rules, what's their set and setting. Because if You know that, right? If you don't have good sleeping schedule, what you're going to get? Bad trip. And it's going to be not really good for a psyche. And it's supposed to be certain conditions. You have to be prepared for a trip. You have to have mental diet. You have to have physical diet. You have to prepare for it. And you cannot just jump on 5 heroic grams, right?
Mm-hmm.
You have to try little by little.
Yeah. And there's other layers to that too, which is that, you know, there's, it sounds like in Russia, is a very extreme version of what has existed here and still kind of does to some extent, which is like drugs are bad unless the drugs we tell you are good. And if they're the ones we tell you are good, they're good. And you take them because we say they're okay. And if they're bad, then they're all bad and they're all death and destruction and you're a bad person and so on and so forth. But I mean, young people aren't dumb. So they try one drug and it turns out that actually it felt pretty good and not really all that much happened. So if that was a lie, then why should they believe anything about the sort of expectations of drugs? Or on another end, it's like if they're choosing to do something that's bad and dangerous and irresponsible, and they believe that the very fact that they're doing it is an expression of that, well, why would they try to behave any other way than irresponsible and dangerous and bad, because that's what they believe that they're doing? And so then they can't use drugs safely because they don't have it in their mind that it's even possible or relevant for them to do so, because they've already become this way of being. And to me, this is a huge problem with the kind of drug education that relies exclusively on sort of narrow-minded, simplistic prohibitionist narratives.
The thing is, in Russia, there is no good stuff. None. So they don't have anything to compare. This is the first. And second, I realized people who using cannabis, if you smoke cannabis in an environment where it's highly prohibited, everybody tells you it's a bad thing. It's 50-50 what person will have panic attack, tachycardia, and a bad trip, even from smoking a little bit. Because if internally you're afraid of it, and you still have on your background, it's bad, and they're waiting, somebody gonna knock on their door and arrest them, it's not good condition to smoke pot, you know? Because marijuana is like lacquer paper, it brings from you whatever you possess at the moment. And I didn't know about that before. I didn't, because when young people start telling me, Masha, I smoke pot and I have anxiety attacks, I have panic attacks, and I feel bad. And I was like, why? And when I start checking on their certain settings and mental certain settings, I discovered marijuana could bring the worst if you don't know what it is, if you're not sure what it is, especially when you try first time in the company of kids somewhere, you know, it's not exactly they can realize right away, oh, that's a good stuff. Why don't you smoke it all the time? That's the point. That's why I went public and I said, yeah, I smoke cannabis for 25 years. You can check my mental condition by my speech, and I will tell you more.
Yeah, you just speaking to that reminds me of being a teenager and consuming cannabis, and the number of times that anytime I heard like a siren, like, oh no, they're coming for me, or like the amount of anxiety, yeah. Even now as a fully grown adult, in a country where cannabis use is legalized, like I can walk past a police officer on the street while smoking a joint, as long as I'm not in front of a school or a kid's play place, which I think are fair rules. It's the same rules for cigarette smoking. I can do that and that's fine. And yet I still have to try to decondition myself that I'm going to get in trouble. Because, right. And yeah, so I can only imagine in a country like Russia where my assumption and what I'm hearing from you is that it's not just that it's bad and you'll get in trouble. The kind of trouble you'll get into is extreme, and the narratives around how bad it is also extreme. And that, you know, that fear is not, it's not foolish. It's a legitimate fear for the kind of trouble that you can get into. how intense that can be on a person's sense of experience, or how much of a detrimental effect that could have in the sort of like possible subsets of experience available to a person consuming the substance.
Yeah, and when I was talking with those kids, I realized you can have a stamp of first not successful experiences, and then you can have those panic attacks for years when you smoke pot, regardless, because it's like an imprint. It's not about adults telling them it's bad. It's about punishment. It's jail, prison, and Russian jails are not very lucky place to be.
I assume as much. So let's shift gears a little bit back into the topic of your book, the results of this incredible sort of almost like worldwide community research project that you're a part of. And it's about microdosing Amanita muscaria. So maybe to start us off, can you give us a sense of this mushroom? Like, what is it? Like, what is it? Where does it grow? And then I'll ask you more questions about its components and its pharmacology and so on and so forth. But let's start with a little general rundown of like, what is it? Where does it grow?
Amanita muscaria grows everywhere on all continents. And there is a lot of information about Amanita muscaria in history. I think everybody knows what it is. It's this mushroom can mix with anything. This is a red cup with white speckles. And as I was told by my parents, since early childhood, it's extremely poisonous. And in my country, in Russia, Amanita muscaria is the center of iconic legends of indigenous people of Siberian tribes, you know, and the very first detailed documented description of Amanita muscaria use by people of far northeast was published by Imperial Academy of Science in St. Petersburg in 1755. And it was two-volume work of Professor Krashenikov. He was a participant of Great Northern Expedition. And we booked named Description of Land of Kamchatka. And Krashenikov described muhamor. Muhamor is another word for Amanita muscaria in Russian language. So he described Amanita muscaria is intoxication in entheogen ceremonies is a food. And after that, more books were published in 1793 by Steller. He was part of Great Northern Expedition as well. And then Lindenau, 1983. First time his book was published. It's a description of people of Siberia. So we have drawings of Amanita muscaria, which are 50,000 old. Imagine a person who draw this gigantic Amanita muscaria mushroom in a cave. He couldn't speak English, obviously, right? So only way to express himself was drawing. So the question is, why did he draw this mushroom? Because it was so beautiful, but there is a lot of beautiful things around now in that time, but obviously this Amanita muscaria mushroom had some meaning for him if he did this drawing on a wall, right? So we cannot ask him what exactly was for him that time, but they found in Australian caves the image of Amanita muscaria. And this mushroom, I collected myself for my own needs on the Pacific East Coast. What state are you in, Jason?
James, I'm in.
Oh, James.
I'm in Ontario in Canada. I'm not sure if Amanita grows here, but I know that I've seen it growing. I've actually seen it growing in Australia. I've also seen it growing in Vancouver as well.
We have Amanita muscaria growing on Pacific Coast from Monterey up to Seattle. It's just different time. Let's say in Seattle, it's August, and when it goes down, it's in San Francisco, the season is December, January, basically right now. And February, March in Monterey, and it does grow more south. And it's a symbiotic mushroom. One of the reasons I started that research because Amanita muscaria could not be monetized. Because, psychedelic mushrooms, they have only one component, right? It's psilocybin. But Amanita muscaria lose its potency with as long as you store it. It's about 6, 7, 8 months. You cannot preserve it. And it's not just about muscimol or ibotenic acid. It's a cocktail of over 200 chemical compounds. And nobody really knows what it is. Because I don't discuss Amanita muscaria for using for psychedelic trips. It's very dangerous, you know. Because with psychedelic mushrooms, there is only one psychedelic agent, and we know exactly what could be if you take 1 gram, 3 grams, or 5, right? With Amanita muscaria, there is no dose you can rely on. Some people can take 5-7 grams and go, shoo. Some people can take 20, 25, nothing happened. I collected over 12,000 cases of taking Amanita muscaria in different doses from 1.1 gram to 50 grams. Nobody died, but they all had different experience. It's very tricky mushroom because let's say if you took 10 grams, nothing, 15 grams, nothing, 20 grams, nothing, and then over 2-3 months you took 10 grams, you're gone. And it's not about die because you get poisoned, loaded with chemicals, overdosed, and die. No. The problem is Amanita muscaria is dissociative. There is a certain dose, an individual for every person, when body and mind got disconnected, and while the person is tripping somewhere in our worlds, the body become extremely aggressive toward itself. People start hitting their heads about walls. They start jumping out of the windows because they totally not connected to their minds. There is no logic thinking. The person is absent. It doesn't matter if you have sitter or group of people. You behave like totally wild animal, totally uncontrollable. Plus, it gave you such a strength. I have a report from a girl which could not be calmed down by 7 big guys. That's how much strength you can get. And it's really dangerous in a meaning of physical injuries, you know. Mostly 99% of people who went from Amanita trip, we wake up in totally ruined house or apartment, just crushed in their urine, their blood, and we don't remember anything what happened.
It's interesting to hear that because I've known of many people to speak very highly of having strong Amanita muscaria trips. There's even a whole person. There's a person on the internet who I've had on the show, Amanita Dreamer, who speaks very highly of these trips. And I am also generally, you know, pretty resistant to like nightmarish stories as like the default way that a trip will go if you take too much. Because I, I mean, I don't have much experience with Amanita Muscaria, so I can't stand by that very strongly. But it is surprising to hear what amounts to, I think what you're saying, amounts to something like, it's just not a good idea, shouldn't be done, dangerous to take psychedelic doses of Amanita Muscaria. Is that what you're saying? Because like it feels, I feel a little weird about that, yeah.
Yeah. There is different levels of Amanita Muscaria chip. Let's say I have a recipe in my book which Amanita Muscaria could be cooked with milk, and you take it by small shots, just like 1-2 sips every 45 minutes or 1 hour, and you cannot have bad experience with it. It depends how it's cooked. I personally took dry Amanita in big quantities, and I took milk, prepared Amanita Muscaria. We're talking about different things. You can have a Amanita Muscaria trip, but there is some point in the trip when your body disconnected from your mind totally. That's the danger. If you know how to prepare the Amanita Muscaria, let's say with milk, it's cooked, you can go in a very, very deep meditation state. Very deep meditation state. And Amanita Muscaria trip is not very visual. It's dark. It's mostly not linguistic. But I'm talking about taking Amanita Muscaria as a dry or fresh in a big quantities.
Yeah. Yeah. So that makes sense. Yeah. So like excessive doses. So, okay, let me see if I get this straight. What you're saying is excessive doses of the compounds, either as a consequence of the variability of the mushroom potency and the variability of the various compounds inside of that potency, as well as preparation method, that it's so variable, you caution people to try to get high enough to have an experience because it might be too easy for them to go over into an excessive experience, at which point it could be quite dangerous. Is that what you're saying?
Yes. And people should know how to prepare Amanita, because you can't just take big quantities. In my book, I have reports from real people, and I have over 1,000 of them when they wake up in a psycho ward, tied up to the bed, or we were running in the forest for 3 days and woke up somewhere all in blood. It's not my fantasy, which I took out of my head. This is from real people. The real people wrote me about it. That's why I have that conclusion. It's not like I tried Amanita and I did not have that experience because I took 15 grams, I took 25 grams, and everything was fine with me. I didn't get disconnected. But the thing is, this information was collected. It's not my opinion. That's a data I got from people. It's a data. And it depends how much do you take to get disconnected totally from this world and leave your body here alone. That's the point.
Yeah, and I think that's a good point. It goes back to, you know, the value and importance of the podcast you're producing for Russian-speaking countries, because, you know, you helped sort of like create a different way of understanding the nuances of substance use, the differences between, you know, like organic psychedelics, dosing, setting dose or whatever, in contrast to just whatever's flooding the streets. So like the harm reduction and benefit optimization sort of potential of solid education is vital, especially with psychedelics, because you could also take too much LSD and be a harm to yourself and others and wake up 3 days later in a forest, right? So I see that point. My initial pushback is what sounded like you suggesting you should never take this in high, you should never take this in psychedelic doses because by default, bad things will happen. I hear now that it was actually much more nuanced than that. And I actually also really appreciate the sort of sharing of these experiences. Like, hey, it can get really bad. This is one of the reasons why you want to be very careful when consuming, preparing, and dosing, and really informed because otherwise harm could happen. It sounds like much of your mandate with what you do is an effort to reduce harm for people who want to explore these substances.
I just want to tell you, because you're an experienced mushroom user, if you take 5 grams of magic mushrooms, or 10 or 15, you're not going to try to kill yourself. You might collapse, don't remember anything, wake up in whatever, 5, 7, 10, 11 hours, and that's it, right? But yeah, maybe, when people, it's not normal what you're going to cut, let's say, cut your body with a knife, right? But I have so many, I have photographs. It's not just letters what people were writing. I have photographs, people with broken face, smart face, wounds in their palms, in their legs. I have all the, I have a whole bunch of photographs what people have done with themselves taking big doses. That's why on my podcast, I even don't want to discuss Amanita Muscaria trips. There is a more, let's say, healthy, less dangerous plants you can take. Let's say, if you want to go to a retreat, just take 3 grams of magic mushrooms. Why you have to take Amanita? You never know what's going to be. It's like a Russian roulette. Maybe some experienced people. But I'm going to tell you, I was observing few people on a video during their Amanita trips, you know. Then blood was running through their face. They was totally uncontrollable. After that, they did not remember what was going on with them. And I just want to repeat myself. It's not my fantasy or my own conclusion. This is the data I got. This is what I got. And why people want to go to Amanita experience that, if you can go with ayahuasca, you can go take San Pedro or peyote, or there is a lot of different plants you can use. Amanita is not psychedelic agent. Why?
I mean, it is, however, a different experience, and there are intrepid people that want that experience, and there are people who are outright vocal about it being a beneficial experience. And so I see the value of ensuring people understand the risks of what they're getting involved with, as well as the value of helping them mitigate that risks if they choose to do so. I don't necessarily see the value of just saying, no, don't, it's bad, you're going to hurt yourself. But it doesn't sound like that's what you're saying, but it does sound like you're strongly vocalizing how dangerous it can get, and thus how dangerous it can get, and thus so people can not be ignorant to their choices and can perhaps otherwise choose to maybe steer clear of something that sounds very dangerous.
James, the reason I vocalize it, because there is no dosage you can take safely. There is none. We know the dosage for ayahuasca. We
you mean no sort of preset dosage, like objective doses? Okay.
No. I have a person who took 1.5 grams of Pantherina Amanita and collapsed in a supermarket in coma for 7 hours. See my point? 1.5 grams. There is no individual dose. There is no middle dose which you can say, okay, this is safe and this is not. Because Amanita muscaria is very different by chemical compounds because of how it was stored, where it was picked up, the level of humidity, the geographical location, how long it was in your storage, how did you prepare it. Everything is changing the chemical compound, and you never can guess. With the magic mushrooms, you can keep it for a year or two, right, dry, and you still know the amount you can take safely. And it's not about physical safetiness with magic mushrooms. It's more mental, you know. The more you take, the more different experience. And if you're not prepared for information, you're going to see that's going to hurt your your brain, but not your body. That's why I wanna talk about it, because there is no dose. Like people, somebody can say, okay, take 10 grams of dry Amanita, you will be fine. It's different for everybody.
Yeah, there's no preset dosing guidelines. Yeah. Each batch would be new. Each batch is entirely so variable that it's very difficult to assess that. I'm hearing that, and I'm really appreciating and seeing and feeling a lot of value in you making that very clear. Yes.
So.
Okay, so the next, let's move on then. So you said there are 200 different chemicals 200 different chemicals inside the mushroom. You also write in your book there are four that are the most studied and the two that most people who have a tertiary understanding of Amanita would know of, ibotenic acid and muscimol. So you had suggested that it's this whole entourage of chemicals that makes a difference to its potency. But there is explicit information about ibotenic acid versus muscimol as extracted things. Do you have a sense of what the difference between these chemicals that we know of are and how they affect us towards an altered state?
Yeah, the ibotenic acid and muscimol were the most studied to this point, and there is a lot of medicines which were produced on that base. And ibotenic acid and muscimol were amino acids, and there are analogs of our neurotransmitters in the central nervous system of in mammals. So ibotenic acid, let's get to muscimol. Muscimol and ibotenic acid is glutamate. It's our natural neurotransmitter, and it's excitatory neurotransmitter, and it plays a central role in brain function. It's important for learning and memory, formation of neural networks. And there is another natural neurotransmitter in our brain. It's a gamma aminobutyric acid, right? So we have two natural neurotransmitters in our brain, in two analogs in Amanita muscaria mushroom, and they have exactly the same effects. But obviously, Amanita is not just ibotenic acid and muscimol. It's a cocktail. It's a cocktail over 200 ingredients. And also, we can trace the same ingredients in other plants. So another thing which I discovered when I was studying science articles, the cups and stems, they were studied separately, and they have different metabolic compositions. So stems and cups, they're totally different in their concentration. Let's say chemical compounds like lecithin, valin, alanin, aspartate, asparagin, fatty acids, halein. It's so many of them. I put it in the first chapter of my book when I talk about pharmacology. But, they were studying effects of muscimol. Let's say garboxazole. Garboxazole is total analog of muscimol. And garboxazole is a patented drug which we used for insomnia, for different mental conditions. But nobody ever studied taking small, little tiny dosages, microdosing of Amanita muscaria of a group of people. It was never done. That's why I was so interested in that, because nobody ever did it. And by now, for 4 years, because I studied Amanita Muscaria effects from 2018 up to 2022, April, and I collected over 12,000 reports on taking Amanita in microdoses, middle doses, and trips. Only 6,000 people by this day, I have over 6,000 people are reported me about Amanita Muscaria microdose effects. And nobody ever studied it. That's why it was so interesting to me.
Yeah, and I was also very interested, which is why you're on the show, why I read your book. And I'm really excited to get into that, to the results in a second. I'd like to ask you a little bit more about ibotenic acid and muscimol, because it seems like there's like you talked about the preparation of the mushroom matters, right? So anytime we prepare something, and it's not just preparing it and grinding it, there's a sort of like, there's an active process that you're going through to change the chemical composition of this mushroom in order to make certain things more available or not. So cooking it, putting it in milk, so on and so forth. And from what I understood, that has something to do with changing the presence or ratio between ibotenic acid and muscimol. Can you speak to why that process matters and what is attempted to be achieved through processing of the mushroom before consumption?
Okay. We have certain ratio of ibotenic acid and muscimol in Amanita muscaria. And just naturally drying Amanita muscaria convert ibotenic acid to muscimol, right? When you store Amanita muscaria, ibotenic acid converts to muscimol. And for everybody, because everybody has different pattern of imprint of our neurotransmitters, which is glutamate and gamma-aminobutyric acid. Let's say there is a accessory and a break, like on the two ends, right? And each individual somewhere in the middle, right? If let's say neural system is I will tell you how I discovered it. I have couple, like husband and wife and elderly people, taking the same Amanita, the same, we collected it with themselves, we store it themselves, and everybody has different effects. That's how we start studying it. Why? And I had a person who helped me, and his name, my associate, his name was Thomas, and Thomas has a very his temperament is he gets angry very quickly, he's very demanding, he's not very patient compared to myself, and we were comparing effects of Amanita muscaria and what we discovered. Let's say me, I can use raw Amanita in very small quantities, right in the forest, size of a cherry. I use Amanita microdoses right off a drying machine. And if Amanita muscaria was stored for 3 months, I don't have the same effect. It's I have nausea, I'm sleepy, it just doesn't affect me very well. Compared to the fresh Amanita, gives me a lot of energy, and I feel good. I have clarity in my mind. And for Thomas, it was total opposite. When he takes more fresh dried Amanita, he has aggression. He cannot sleep. He has floaters and dark spots in his vision, and he got really agitated. That's how we discovered it. So we put the questions for our people. As I mentioned before, we had 8,000 people in live chats. So I start posting those questions. Tell me what effects you have when you use fresh dried and Amanita stored for 3 months. And we discovered 30% of my auditory, they could use fresh Amanita. 30% they can use only Amanita, which was stored for 3-4 months when ibotenic acid converts to racemol, and 30% doesn't care. They don't care. You know? I cannot put any theories, and I don't want to even create the theories. I just want to report about effects I got. Because we can talk about those theories, what does it cause, why, and I just don't want to go there because my goal was explore the range of diseases which might be corrected by Amanita microdosing. I'm not saying treated or cured, because my questions I posted was, let's say I have this and this and this condition. I take Amanita muscaria for that load and that dosage. Does it help me with my condition? No results, or I feel worse. That's how I studied it. And I was studying the degree of influence, and then I want to study stability of microdosing effects. Is it stable, or when you, let's say a person has insomnia. Amanita muscaria does not work like a sleeping pill. You take it, you sleep. You don't take it, you don't. If you take Amanita for several months with breaks, it restores your sleep. It restores, and then you can sleep with no Amanita at all. And my goal was research what's the personal microdose size based on results of individual experiments. Then we have, nobody knew how to take it. So we didn't know about the optimal form, duration, you know, everything what I have, because I got so many results from volunteers, and I systematize it and I put it in a form it could be readable and understandable. But to put the theories behind it, I can't. Because Amanita muscaria affects so many conditions, and they are so different. This could be hormonal dysfunction. This could be some mental conditions. I mean, it's so many, and the range of those conditions is so wide. That's why I kind of stay away from explaining why it happened. Why? I just want to present the data.
Mm-hmm. And I suppose leave it to other researchers to form hypotheses, which can be tested against using the data. And then from there, come to understandings of mechanisms and so forth. Because right off the bat, I mean, it seems the way that you're describing that, seems like some people are more or less tolerant to a higher concentration of muscimol versus ibotenic acid. It seemed like maybe at some point you were about to suggest that possibly that has an association with their sort of like their disposition with respect to glutamate or GABA, and how it is associated to their sort of homeostatic function, disease, or health. You didn't make that explanation, although in my mind it seems like a logical hypothesis to start with and test against. But one thing I was just thinking about, and you're welcome to respond to that as well, what I just said, is you making the comment about, you know, like it restoring the sleep. And from what I understood, you also talked about gaboxadol, which was a muscimol analog, and that was the one that I don't think it actually ended up going to market, because I looked about whether or not I could get it, but it didn't end up going to market. It seemed like the muscimol in particular has an effect on sleep. So going back to the sleep thing, do you find that the 30% who preferred early, 30% who preferred 3 months, blah, 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 that separation, did you find that, say, the people who preferred the freshly dried stuff could still use it before going to bed? Or would they be more likely to use it in the morning and or vice versa?
James, there is a difference, which is very surprising to me, which I discovered. the time of consuming is very important. If you take this mushroom, let's say 0.5 gram in the morning, person has energy. Let's say in general, we don't discuss right now fresh, dried, or later. In general, person has energy, clarity of mind, can work for many hours, physical strength, good mood, the negative thoughts shut down, this chatterbox in the head. And if the same person takes Amanita Muscaria in the evening, it works as a sleeping agent. That's the difference. The problem is Amanita Muscaria restores the biological clock. So if people want to restore their sleep, they have to go sleep before 10 p.m. Because if people take Amanita Muscaria at midnight, it has opposite effect. It will become more energized. That's the problem. But in general, what I have, because, you know, there is a medicine, there is a science, and there is a fact. I'm on the facts in this book and on this research. I just present the facts. I have 76% of Amanita Muscaria restoring the sleep, restoring, not working as a sleeping pill, 76. No side effects. And 3 weeks break, 3 weeks break, and you can see result for itself. 76. Next one is, let's say, depression. 80% of people report positive effects. And the winner is, in my research, we discovered it with this group of people, first time in a with Amanita Muscaria. Nobody ever talk about it. So we find out what Amanita Muscaria microdoses is antidote for many, many different addictions. Let's say alcohol, 86%. Because I believe for people with alcoholism, there is no placebo. I was born in a country where everybody was drinking excessively. Placebo doesn't work for those people. And I have 86% of people cured alcoholism. We don't drink at all. 36%, we don't drink anymore. And lower their alcohol consuming. And only 12% of people return to previous state. The same I have with Amanita Muscaria is a dependency antidote to opioids. Let's say methadone, fentanyl, oxycodone, heroin, 74%, James. Designer drugs, bath salts, 89%. Amphetamine, 76%. Cocaine, 75%. That was the most great discovery to me personally, is a dependency antidote. And I have what else we discovered, which is, using Amanita Muscaria tincture, alcohol tincture, the recipe is in my book. You prepared it with alcohol from a raw mushroom, and it takes inflammation, swelling, and pain. 92% reports gave me positive effect of taking pain when it's applied on the skin.
Like the alcohol is applied to the skin.
Alcohol tincture. I personally use it in, I had a great effect. That's what started pushing me toward that study, because I injured myself at the gym. And I had pain in my back so bad. In 2016, I barely could walk, and I could not you use anything to cure that condition, and only Amanita Muscaria tincture put me on my back. By now, I don't have it. I know I have a bulge, but it doesn't bother me. I can hike for 20 miles. Every week, I go to Pacific Coast to pick up Amanita. And 6 years ago, my condition was not very good. So you have to store Amanita alcohol tincture for 40, 45 days. I don't know what chemical process, some maybe fermentation, whatever, because raw Amanita juice does have bad properties. I tried everything on myself. So you have 95% proof alcohol, mix it 2 pounds of crushed Amanita cups, 250 milliliters of alcohol. You store it in a dark place for 40, 45 days. Then you put it through the filter and use, it's a red, bright red liquid. And it gets to the point, it's not 95 anymore. It's between 20, 25. So it doesn't burn your skin. You can do the compress. You can apply it overnight. You can just spray it on your skin. Let's say it takes itch and inflammation with poison oak. If the bee bites, the wasp bite, I tried everything on myself and it works. 25 minutes, the pain goes away immediately. This summer I got attacked by wasps and I got bitten both hands, left and right, because I have a mind of mad scientist. I decided, okay, now I'm gonna try if it's placebo or not. I put a compress over my right hand and I did not put it over my left one. The pain went away in 27 minutes and I still could not bend my fingers, but I could work with my right hand, the left one. 12 hours later, it was size of the pillow, the allergy was going up to my shoulder and the pain was unbearable. So 12 hours later, after the bite, I have to put the tincture over. That was my own experience, my own study, if it's placebo or not. That's why I just present the facts. I'm not saying it's very accurate information, you know, but even if you divide it by two, it's still good.
Mm-hmm. So I want to ask you a bit about placebo in a second, because it is. I mean, we don't understand how the placebo mechanism works. And for one thing to have such a broad sort of like set of positive benefits, from mental health to decreasing inflammation on the skin, it would seemingly be unreasonable to assume, unless we could hypothesize and prove a sort of like central or set of central mechanisms that allow for such a broad effect, that some degree of these actions would be associated with placebo. The same could be said for any medical drug that gets taken into trial. Even if it is shown as effective, some amount of it will still be attributed to placebo. But first, I want to ask a very specific question, which is, with did anybody report any issues with their memory? And the reason I'm asking this is because one of the hallmarks of GABAergic drugs is damage to the memory system. And one of the things that happens for people who take higher doses of the Amanita is they don't remember what happened. They don't remember who they are. There's obvious memory issues. Did anybody report long-term microdosing having any impact on their memory at all, given that there's an association there with the GABA system?
The thing is, the pills you're talking about is just pure muscimol, you know? We're talking about taking Amanita Muscaria and the amount of chemicals is so small. We're not talking about even muscimol in
I wasn't talking about muscimol pills either. I meant like any kind of GABAergic, Valium, Xanax.
I have a question.
Yeah.
I have a question about memory restoring. It's working opposite. Because I have over 70% memory improved toward memory loss. And we're talking about microdoses. And when we were talking about big amounts of Amanita muscaria, people have amnesia. It's temporarily. We don't remember what happened to them when they were under influence of big quantities. But I posed that question because my listeners, they were proposing me the questions. And I posted the question, and it's about 250 people answered on that question. The memory is becoming better than it was. That's what I have. Because we take the amount of chemicals in half gram of dry mushroom is so little. Because there is not the quantity is important, the regularity is, as we discovered, an individual dose of Amanita muscaria, when you take it and you don't have any effects, like vitamins. When we take vitamins, we don't feel anything, right? So the individual Amanita muscaria dose is when you don't have any positive or any negative effects. You took it and forget it. But when you look back after a week or 10 days or 2 weeks, you see the changes.
So people don't notice like immediate effect. Like I could see this in the sense of mental health or whatever, but you even said like some people will like get perked up. Is that not something that happens right away, or is that something that happens as a consequence of a few days?
Let's say when I start using Amanita microdoses for the first time in 2016, you take Amanita, you don't feel anything. I didn't feel anything. But when I look back, before I go sleep, I realize I was working on my garden all day, working with my shovel, cutting the trees, doing all this stuff, and I was like, wow. But you don't feel like blast of energy, and you take your shovel, you go and work on your garden. No, it's so subtle, That's the thing. That's how we determine the minimal dose you can take. It's half gram or less. And I did not run the chemical liquid chromatography. I was going to because I have access to equipment and everything. But then I realized if I can just study two compounds like ibotenic acid or muscimol and give the nanograms in microdose, it doesn't do anything because we're talking about 200 different components. And I don't think what just muscimol or ibotenic acid are the main agents. So that's why I stay away from theories and everything or explanation how does it work. I don't know. So somebody else will do it if they want.
So I'd like to end the interview with questions about, so what is the microdosing protocols actually look like? What was discovered? But first I want to jump back. I want to call back to that question about placebo I think what's the saying, like a causation fallacy, which is like, I started doing this thing got better. And because I started doing this thing before this thing got better, then it was obviously that thing that made this thing better. Or placebo effect, which is I took it, I believed it was going to work. And so some mysterious mechanisms unfolded and now it's working, but it wasn't actually the pharmacological physical thing. It was something. You have a lot of data, right? And it seems like you've taken good care to sort of analyze and assess that data. You obviously have a background understanding in how to acquire data. You said you're a medical doctor, so you obviously have some sort of background and understanding how to read medical literature and clinical research. Do you have a sense of, to what degree you might suspect that placebo effect and or this causation fallacy is accounting for your results? Or do you not have a hypothesis at all about it? And you're like, this is just the data, make up your own mind. Because to me, I feel like there's got to be some influence of it in there somewhere. Right. So what are your thoughts on that?
I have proof. I don't have thoughts. I have proof. I have facts. Let's say I have about 100 people around me, my friends, my close friends who trust me, my family, which I use Amanita tincture. And I didn't tell them what it was. They even didn't know what I do because Amanita Muscaria is not connected to my personal life. And most of my friends, and they don't know I wrote a book. I don't want to connect my name to this research and this psychedelic podcast. I had people which were, let's say I have a friend, he was 78 years old. He was going on a surgery because of his prostate problems, and he has swelling of his lower extremities, his legs. It was enormous size, painful, red skin, and his doctor prescribed him a lot of different pills. Nothing could help him. And he was visiting me, and he started saying, I have that and that and that. And I said, let me try something on you. So I put it on his legs, and I gave him a very small bottle of Amanita tincture, which I prepared myself. And I said, use it in the morning and use it at night before you go to sleep. Just put it over, take a small bottle, and just spray it. I didn't tell him what it was, and it helped. Right before he went to the surgery, he went to his doctor, and his doctor said, wow, what did he do? What did you do? I have people who had a poison oak, the people I observed, because I'm a doctor, I know how to ask questions. Pain after injuries, like broken bones, the bruises, the pain, the swelling. I didn't tell them what it was. And when I said, let me try this, just take this one, try it. What is it? I didn't tell anybody what it was. And I have 100% proof it works. That's the thing. It's not a theory. It's not from, I observed it.
Well, this is a very specific sort of, this is a very specific thing that you're speaking about. A topical application to pains, inflammations, etc. What about you have a wide range of effects. You even said that you had results that suggest it's an antidote to addictions. There's mental health effects, there's cognitive effects, there's all these sort of this huge range of positive effects that you found. Do you not feel that placebo effect or causation fallacy could be?
It could be. I'm not saying it's not. I'm not saying, but as James Fadiman said, if placebo works, what is your problem?
I agree. Yeah. Yeah. And even some of the research that came out that suggest LSD microdosing is placebo or something. My first response is Chris Killam. He's another guy, he's an author, hilarious guy. He was talking about it. He used the term a classic case of rectal cranial inversion. And I would agree that suggesting it's placebo is something to that effect. But I still think it's a very relevant question to be asking when we're trying to, because you're presenting the data, but the thing is like, as you're presenting the data itself tells a story, right? But the story that the data tells will also have a lot to do with the questions we ask ourselves. And if we're not asking the question of placebo, we might be missing a very important set of data that is not revealed, or information generated out of the data that would not be revealed until we ask those questions, which is why I'm asking.
I agree. And I didn't study it. Definitely I don't have access to the group, nor I want it. You know, I don't want to build the groups. I don't want to do placebo blind double studies. I did what I did and I finished it, and I am researching totally different natural things on myself. And I'm done with it. I did my dues. It was totally accidental. I didn't plan that book. I didn't plan that research, and I did what I could because information was just basically available to me. Because I had so many followers, so many listeners, and you're right, James, it could be some percent of placebo, but as a doctor, I'm wondering, why don't we just study the placebo effect?
Oh, totally. Maybe, yeah.
Maybe we don't need anything. Maybe we just need a placebo and it can cure because our body is capable of healing itself. We just don't know the mechanism. Why don't we study that except of discovering new pharmacological products?
I think money has something to do with the answer to that question of why we don't, because there's money in one, and money in proprietary copyrights and the like in one and not in the other.
Oh,
unless
yeah.
someone can copyright a certain series of hand movements that activate the placebo effect, but I doubt it's that simple. So let's finish off with, I want to hear just I don't want you to go into too much detail here, because if people want more detail, they can follow up with your book. But what did you find? Like, out of it, there must have been sort of like, okay, generally it seems like... I'll cut all that out. So the question was, now that we're back, tech issues resolved. The question was about what you learned out of all the data, what seemed to be the most optimal dosing strategy. So by that I mean the method and the timing. So for example, you know, James Fadiman, he has his like every fourth day sort of protocol. Paul Stamets has the, what is it, 5 days on, 2 days off for psilocybin protocol. What was found with the Amanita Muscaria? Does it work with the 1 day on, 2 days off thing? Do you take it 3 months in a row? Do you take it for 2 days? So what is the sort of dosing strategy that was found to be the most sort of broadly effective for people?
What we find out for 4 years of research with what Amanita Muscaria could be taken every day, in the morning, once a day or twice, and the dose should not exceed 1 gram. And it, you can take 0.3 gram, 0.2 grams every day, let's say for 3-4 weeks, take a break and observe the effects. Do you have any effects or you don't have any effects? And then you continue like 2, 3, 4 courses per year. But I'm talking just about my study and what I discovered. To tell you the truth, I don't want to advise people how to take it. And I'm not promoting or advocating consulting or Amanita Muscaria microdoses. I just present the data I collected, you know. And I have to say, I don't advise you to take Amanita Muscaria without consulting your doctor before I say anything. I just want to present the data which I collected. The most effective way to take Amanita Muscaria is once a day, twice a day, for a certain period of time, and then take a break. That's the protocol which we discovered together, and it's based on over 6,000 people reports. That's why in my book, the big part of my book, I present the letters from people, because if we read those letters, we can see how different Amanita Muscaria affects everybody. That's why I put over 1,000 reports of people taking Amanita in small dosages. So we have prehistory, they talk about the preconditions, they take how did they take it, how often did they take, how long did they take, and you can see how different it affects everybody. That's what it is. But I don't want to consult anyone on taking Amanita, really.
Well, I mean, especially with the dose variability you were speaking to, I mean, the most you could do is educate people on safe preparation and collection and let them hopefully make their own choices. With that said, you had said, you know, what the data suggested was like, would you say 0.5 gram or less? Is that what you said? Sorry?
Yeah.
So, and that would be, is that like powdered? Is that dried powdered? Because I know that you also mentioned there's something to do with milk, and then there's the liquid preparation. And then also I know that, you know, it seems like it's possible to smoke Amanita, or some people do. Like, what did you notice the differences there? Or did it sort of default like, yeah, the most safe and effective and secure way is to prepare it as a dry, prepare it as a powder and take 0.5 gram or less?
It could be taken as a powder. You just take, people took it mostly with an empty stomach. The reason we are talking on empty stomach, because acidity of our guts, of our stomach, on empty stomach is 2.7 pH. And 2.7 pH transform ibotenic acid to muscimol as well. That's the reason. And it could be taken as a, you can soak the powder in a warm water for 20-25 minutes and just drink the water, because all the chemical compounds in the Amanita muscaria is water soluble. And you can just take a small piece of cup. The better way to ground it before you take it, because it's kind of consolidate the whole thing, you know, because you have different mushrooms. You just powder it and take it as a powder form. But it really does matter if you take it on empty stomach. Our body will take everything, even like you take a small piece of cup and chew it. Doesn't make any big difference. And about chemicals, let's say somebody picked up Amanita muscaria near the road or near chemical factory in like a bad in the environment, like let's say chemical garbage, whatever field. This could be very dangerous, because Amanita, like any other mushrooms, sucks all the poison from ground, heavy metals and our mercury, anything. It's not just Amanita, every, basically any mushroom. If people pick them up in a not safe place, it could be real dangerous. That's the problem. That's why I wrote about my research. Is everything I know, everything I find out is in a book. There is no really questions I can answer, because everything I know, it's in a book. And when people say, oh, Masha, I have bad condition, what should I do? I don't know. I don't want to advise you. My study was based on volunteers. It's not like went public and said, okay, people, let's take Amanita and report to me. It was all the people worked with me, they were volunteers. So that's...
Well, then
did I answer your question?
Yes, I still remain very curious about smoking.
Smoking, right.
Yeah.
You can try smoking. It's not good. I tried myself. Some of my listeners reported to me. You don't go to the trip. You have like a very dull, the more you smoke, the more like kind of dull you become. And it's not a very pleasant experience. It's not when you smoke cannabis, it's totally wasting of product.
Okay.
I tried it several times. I tried the bong, I tried the joint, it doesn't work. And the same data I got from people who smoked it. Nothing. Basically nothing. Nothing positive, I mean.
Okay, noted. So here's the last question. Where can people get access to your book, and where can they follow more about what you're doing?
I shut down this project because of war. Because my listeners, they were both from Russian Federation and Ukraine. And I didn't want to broadcast anymore because of that bad situation, because, you know, all this situation is very sad. But I opened a YouTube channel, which has 20 videos with explanation. And I put information. Everything I find out is on that channel. The channel is Microdosing with Baba Masha. If you put on search Amanita Muscaria Baba Masha, the channel will pop. And most of the videos by now, they have English subtitles. I will finish it soon, in a couple of weeks. So it's not important what I show. And it's about everything. Where do I find out my Amanita? How I prepare the tincture? How do I dry Amanita for consuming in microdoses? How it affects that different nosological groups. So everything which is in the book in a short version is on YouTube channel. It's called Amanita Muscaria Microdosing Baba Masha.
Great. And the name of your book again is?
Microdosing Amanita with Amanita Muscaria. It's they sell it on Amazon and major stores as well.
Yeah, because it's inner traditions. Is that right? Inner traditions?
Yeah, inner traditions,
yeah. Major publishers. So anyone could probably even go to their small bookstore and get it ordered to them. No problem with going to purchase from Amazon.
Yeah, it's in Barnes and Nobles and all other stores. I mean, I think they sell it everywhere. Yeah, but if people don't want to buy the book, they can go to my YouTube channel. It's free. No advertising. I keep it clean from any commercial stuff because that's what I want. And I talk about everything, and we can translate the comments. There's like 300, 400, 500, 600 comments under each video, and people sharing information. And if English speaking people click on a comment, YouTube translates it. They can post the comments, they can read the discussion, because discussion under each video is more valuable than the video, because people sharing information, how they use it, what was effects, and if read the comments, you can see it works. It works, but me personally, I don't want to be connected, I don't want to consult, I shut down everything right by now. Because I'm studying different things right now, some natural remedies.
Well, thank you for everything that you've put out and shared all this data, the work that you've put in. Thank you for coming on the show, Baba Masha. Thank you so much. And I hope that the research you're doing now turns out to be as fruitful and interesting as the work that you've completed with the Amanita Muscaria.
All right. Thank you.
Okay. That's all for this episode. Thanks for listening. Thanks for tuning in all the way to the end. Again, if you like what you heard there, and you'd like to get a little bit more of a thorough look at the data, Microdosing with Amanita Muscaria is available at all major bookstores. What's interesting about this book is, you know, like a solid half of it is literally the anecdotal reports of people. There's a number of different sort of graphs and explanations. I'm showing some of them on the screen here of the data. And then there's a lot of opportunity to hear exactly what it was like for people. So if that interests you, check out the book. And otherwise, check out Masha's other work online. Furthermore, if you appreciate the value of this podcast or you're experiencing value in this podcast and you would like to support it financially, please do so by becoming a patron on Patreon, where you can offer a monthly amount to say, hey, thanks for making the show. Here's a little tip in advance to cover all of the expenses, financial and otherwise, that go into producing this show. You can head to jameswgesso.com/support, where you can find options about Patreon, as well as other ways to support, one-time donations, purchasing things from the shop, purchasing copies of my book, et cetera, et cetera. Or you could just head straight to Patreon and link is in the description to this episode, wherever you're checking it out. And I really appreciate you doing that. It helps to create a kind of reciprocation of effort and value that feels beautiful in a way, because it's totally voluntary. I'm not asking you to pay money to listen to these episodes, but if you find value in them, you can give back for what you received and give back in an ongoing way that allows me to continuously produce them. So big thank you for that, if you're into it. And that's it. Like I said at the beginning, this is the last podcast episode of the year, and I'm very happy that you tuned in all the way to the end. I'm very happy that you tuned in at all. And for whatever it is worth to you, in whatever way that you choose to celebrate this turning of the calendar, I wish you well, and I'll see you on the other side of December 31st. Until then, take care.